Terug. There we are. There we are. We've gone red. I'm in studio. The moment we go red, we're online. All right, guys. For me, this is the third day coming back into studio. These studios are fully booked. A lot of people coming through you, lecturing you. A lot of things going on in this institution. It's not just this in the school. A lot of other schools too. And you just saw my IT guy there in the back again, sneaking out of here. I don't know why he's going bent, because you can see me. Might as well walk straight up. In any event, right? Well, okay. It's like I said, it's a third clip, third day for you, most probably. For you, it's an ongoing process. Third day for me, third clip. Okay, guys. Just a quick announcement. When you receive this material. The recordings are big, it's raining, signals are very weak. We're doing this, streaming is involved, the IT guy gave us a big explanation here. And this results in the visual being good, you can see me. The sound being good, you can hear me. But the visual and the sound is not always together. It means my lips are moving, but the sound may be in front or in the back. So don't worry about that. The whole time I'm working with you, I'm saying we're on page this, we're on page this. And all I want you to do is I want you to just follow through with that. All right. So we have said a lot about the liquidation and distribution account. And if there's time over, we can go back and look at it again. That'll be nice. And so on. And we've spoken about a lot of things. And we have also reiterated ongoing that you're a distance learner and you have got a tremendous responsibility upon you to look after that part of the education, that self-study part of the education. So reach out with a lot of examples, etc., etc., and so on, so that you can be assisted in that. And then if you go into the back of your guide, I'm looking to the back of your guide, what I've done this year is there is so many examples. But what is great about your guide is I'd like to go to the back of your guide. Actually, I think before, let me just have a look at this, because you've got to be, that's good. I think what I'm going to do today, starting off with, is before we go on page 170, I'm going to start again with the valuation of usufructs for estate duty purpose. Let's just page quickly to page 281. I just want to make certain that we're on the same page regarding liquidation and distribution account. You've got a wonderful example here. So you don't have a reason when you go through the learning material I've explained to say, but I don't know what's going on. The scenario for this liquidation and distribution account actually starts on page 278. And then they give you the whole thing there, and they give you questions, and they tell you what's going on. I want to take you to the liquidation and distribution account very quickly, a couple of minutes. I hope you're there, to page 281. There you will see the heading. This is it. Now, usually on top of that block, we will still type just a heading for the whole thing, liquidation distribution account, as I have explained in the previous clips. But that's your heading. And remember what I said about it, that's marks. If they ask you that, remember, you've got to read your question. Remember what I said. So let's read the first important factor, the first important column heading, the heading column or the heading division of your liquidation and distribution account. The first and final liquidation and distribution account in the testate estate of the late John Smith, identity number so-and-so, who died on so-and-so and who was married in community of property to Mary Smith born Klein with identity number so-and-so. And below it, that master reference number there. So that's 4 or 5 marks just there. And you can see the full explanation is in there. And when we taught you in clip 1 and 2, we even said you can put more things in there, but this is the minimum requirements. So please, then you would recall the first division we're dealing with is a liquidation account. And before we even start with the liquidation account, we have decided to use a free column, approach here. Now, oh yes, they use all the free columns. I'll show you in a second. This is great. I believe in the free column thing, because you would recall there was some calculations we had to do that was actually you have to do in the third column, then transfer them into the second column, because normally you won't even see them. But if you do them, you know they're right. So in your liquidation account on page 281, there it is, your immovable property. And that keeps on running until the bottom of page 281. There you have it, the movable property. So let me just, I need to page this correctly. Okay, we can do it like that. And then further on, you'll see they have there on page 282 under your movables. So we have your immovables and movables. There you have a vehicle, a firearm, you have coins there, household, furniture, and ornaments. And there you have, look at that, do you remember? There you have shares in a private company. Remember what we said, you have to say what is going on here. That's very important. And then you have a close corporations, loan account, shares in public companies. You have stockbrokers. You have unit trust on page 283. Going to page 284, there you have a Sunlip Collective Investment. And then going on, do you remember? There you have the claims in favor of the estate. Not against the estate. Remember, that comes under liabilities. So claims in favor of the estate. And there they have the Absa Bank, bank accounts, Standard Bank, insurance, Old Mutual, Momentum, and they keep on running there. It comes from page 284 and it merges into page 285. And in the middle of page 285, ladies and gentlemen, the total assets, 9,450,457.91. That amount must be right. If you get the total gross value of your estate wrong, then obviously all your calculations later on is going to be wrong. And in the exam, we are looking for the correct answers, obviously. So usually you'll get some marks for your heading and your certificate for your divestment notes. The better your divestment notes, you're going to get your marks. You'll get a little bit marks in your first information column. But we're looking for correct amounts. If you're out of a cent, you're going to get marked wrong. So those are the things you have to look at. And there you have your total assets and right behind it. Now we know how strong and value this liquidation and distribution account is. And now we need to determine what the liabilities is. Because there's a couple of things we've got to figure out. Do you remember? Is it insolvent? Do we have liquidity or illiquidity in terms of cash shortfall or surplus? We need to arrive at certain points to understand what we're going to be doing. And we need to know if it's a Section 18 free deceased estate. We know it's not. Because it's over 250,000 rand, it's 9.something million rand. So that's where we're at. Then we go into liabilities. Under liabilities, do you remember the administration expenses, the advertising, going on to page 286? And do you remember creditors? Now, please, there's the creditors, the liabilities. Remember the creditors. Tombstone funeral costs now falls, strictly speaking, under the creditors. Then we work out, we have your creditors, we have your administration expenses, and we go into page 287, and at the bottom, we have your total liabilities. Yeah, total liabilities. And is this state there, they talk about estate duty, and then they talk about the balance for distribution. Now, that is the things that you have to look at. So then they work that out and they merge that into, on page 288, into the recapitulation statement, which is very important. So there you look at the recapitulation statement, and you can look at your cash surplus there. And do you see now what I meant with the parentheses, the itemized numbers in brackets? Look at your recapitulation statement there on page 288. That's why. Then by cash assets and assets reduced to cash. Now, remember, I'm just going through this to show you what we have been talking about. So the last little bit of confusion leaves you. And then there's the item numbers you deal with. According to the law, according to your book and your guides are saying, remember, you only want to pass the deceased estate, and if you can pass it with a distinction, that's great. But in the future, you will become so experienced, and you'll know all the ins and outs. I call it streetwise, because as litigators, we walk in courts and we fight these things in courts, and that's where the streetwise comes in. So there you have it. They talk about your liabilities, your stay duties there. They talk about the children and Nelson Mandela Fund you see there, and then they get to that cash surplus there, and everybody's happy. If you have a cash surplus, you're happy. If you don't have an insolvent situation, you're happy. And there is your recapitalization division. Now you'll remember what I said. And if you now scroll back, because you've got a benefit, you can rewind, push the rewind button, and you can go back. Distribution account up now, because we need to arrive somewhere. And then we bring over the balance brought forward for distribution. And then you'll see the Mary Smith, and then you'll see the investment notes there, the balance for distribution there. And when we are finished there, we are walking in there to the legatees, and then divestment notes are going to be very important there. And then on page 289, we go there through the Nelson Mandela Children's Fund, and we arrive at what is very important, balance for distribution to heir, or balance for distribution to heirs, whatever the situation might be. And that is very important, because that is then what we have over and what we're going to be dispensing with. And then we have our divestment notes there. Our award is very important. They always give a mark for award. And you will see they talk there about Mary Smith. And if we page, then again, assets awarded and not realized. So we are not giving cash out here. We are awarding assets. And that's the values not realized. Assets awarded and not realized. There's a slash there, and you'll see the parenthesis again. That's how we indicate the item numbers. And then, of course, now we're gone. We have done the recapitalization account. We have merged into the distribution account, and we want to look in the income and expenditure account. There's our income, Absa Bank, and net bank, amount collected, amount per account, and the net bank. We've got that interest there. And then we go into our expenditure, and again, we arrive at your secondary balance for distribution, and in the expenditure account, and the situation is becoming just more clear and clearer to us. We see here we don't have any fiduciary assets account. It's null. And remember that null, and also type in those zeros, because sometimes the markers don't see the null and they don't give you that solid one mark, not even a half mark. Usually you get a solid mark there. And then very important, there's the estate duty schedule. And the chronological flow now of this whole liquidation account, I'm going now slowly through it. And you can remember what I've said in clip, especially in clip two, right? And you can now see what we've been talking about. What a marvelous example here. And you might actually differ from that. Don't be surprised if you take this scenario and you work it out, you get different amounts. Don't be like, hey, there's a mistake here. You will you won't believe how people sometimes balance those things on different approaches. And it's unfortunate to say that, right? But it is the truth. It happens. There's the estate duty schedule. You talk, there's the assets, and they talk about them, less the adjustments, etc., etc., plus foreign assets. I have to now give a legal opinion on foreign assets. It has to go in here. And then, of course, that deemed property, less the deemed property. And look again at the parenthesis, where we have item 19, item 21, item 22. And then we go back, we list the liabilities, and we work all of those things out. And we plus the deemed property. And if you work through this, you will see at the end of it, it amounts to the dutiable amount on page 292, which we utilize that rebate there. And we actually see that the value of the estate at the end of all of this, that's going to be possibly dutiable as 3.2 million. But if we usually utilize that 3.5 rebate, then it goes into a minus, 240,000 rand minus. So we're not over 3.5 million rand. So the dutiable amount then will be null. Just right there, on a dutiable amount, 20%. I see it's not typed in yet. They don't do it. I usually do it if I work on these things, instructed to do it if they're difficult. And then of course, you know, it's 20%. So I just wanted to show you. And I haven't now studied the scenario. So I can't really get into the specifics of it. For that to do, I need to go to a scenario and see how whoever worked this liquidation distribution account arrived here. So you might think, oh, he's passing over things. No, not at all. Obviously, if I have to work through the scenario, we'll sit here for 2 days and so on, maybe a couple of hours. So there you see it in practice. And where is your marks? Please have a look. that your executive certificate and make certain you sign it and date it. And that's it. There you have it. We are happy with that. And this is how it looks. And I wanted to go back and show you. So let's quickly, I can show you on page 291 in the estate duty schedule. There you can see why we sometimes have three callers rather than two. And if you want to go on my experience and my advice, then obviously I will be the guy that always tell you to go for three columns. All right, now we can start lecturing and finishing up the subject. And after that, maybe we'll just peruse through the annexures also to show you what's in the book. It's important. I have seen that candidates has a propensity to not look at annexures. They look at the pertaining annexures like the liquidation distribution account, everybody will go and look at. But they don't pay too much mind to annexures. And that's very wrong. In these guides, we give you a simple example. With the new Legal Practice Act, the Legal Practice Council has got norms and standards. And this institution and the other four institutions registered to the company to do this kind of training, there's only five currently, they have to comply. Their learning outcomes have to comply with the norms and standards of the Legal Practice Council. And one of the things is case management. Case management is a big thing in South Africa. We're actually changing our whole approach to litigation. The emphasis is not anymore on winning the case, but more than settling and negotiating and see if we can amicably resolve disputes before they go into a court and they go into full blast litigation, cost a lot of money. Case management is actually one of the tools that has to assist with that as well as negotiation and settlements. So in case management, in a lot of your other guides, not this one, we would attach it. We would sometimes attach the, if we're working on these things, we would attach the newest notice from the LPC. And you need to study that, because if you get into the exam, obviously the newest amendments and the newest notices issued by the LPC will be the prevailing authority on what that happens there. So that is why annexes is very important. And if we have time, we'll go through there. Well, thank you very much. That's that then. Let's go to page 170. I'll give you a second. Go there through page 170, and if the visual is good, the sound is good, but if the sound, the visual, my lips are moving, there's no sound, suddenly the sound comes, please, 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 we know about it. First of all, we know about it, and we will run this through certain programs to see if we can amend it, but it's a massive data load and so on, and I don't always understand what the IT guys are saying to me, but we take their word for why it's like this, and they are working on it. I'm sure that other presentations might be not have this little defect. It's a little defect. You can see me, you can hear me. All right, there we are. Page 170, valuation of usufructs for estate duty purposes. It has been stated above that a usufruct is a right of enjoyment over property and that ownership does not vest in usufructuary. How then does one calculate the value of this right of enjoyment, which now accrues to some other person? And I know I read this piece on in the second clip. You're all hearing this in a couple of minutes now. You think I'm repeating myself. For me, it's a day in between. So I'm just doing it over. Section 5.1b deals with the valuation of a usufruct. You are referred to the relevant provision of the Estate Duty Act. And we have calculations coming later on again. And there you can look at it. But there you can find it. Follow the guidelines in Section 5.1b. And you'll know what the value is of that. Consideration, terminologically forward, annual value of the right of enjoyment of the property, where a person has the right only to enjoy the income arising from the property, as is the case here. The obvious way in which the value of that right is to base the valuation on the annual amount of the income which that property yields. Difficulties may be encountered in ascertaining the exact amount of the annual income received from the property. In any event, it is the value of the future income that is to be ascertained, not that of the past. And this results in the valuer having to estimate the future annual yield of the property. And there they explain the annual value of the right of enjoyment of a property means an amount equal to 12% upon the fair market value of the full ownership of the property. I just want to say something here. What do you enjoy? You can live there, but let's say it's a farm, it's got fruit trees and you're selling the fruit off. So go look at the law. It tells you what's happening there. And that's, for example, the income you can then live off. On page 171, they talk a little more about Section 5.2. However, section 5.2 contains a provision that where the commission is satisfied that the property could not reasonably be expected to produce an annual yield of 12%, he may fix the sum representing the annual yield. I'm not even going to go far in there. It has to do with the fact that if you're not happy with the first part in 5.2, then the commissioner has the discretion and authority to set in motion 5.2. And then you'll see the 12%, and then you'll see there the present value of R1 per annum for life capitalized to 12% over the expectation of life for males and females of various ages. And that is all the data you have to take into consideration when you calculate the market value of the property multiplied by 12% multiplied by the factor determined by the tables gives one the annual value capitalized at 12% over the expectation of the lives of males and females in table A, or being used the fixed period table B to determine the value for fixed periods, for example 1 year, 5 years, 10 years and so on. So before I go on, because the first question people ask me is, what now? Where is those tables? Let me take you to the tables. I'm sure they are in here. Let me just quickly browse through here. Otherwise, we can look this afternoon if I don't find it quickly now. But these tables you can pull down from the internet. Oh, here they are. Go to page, go quickly for me to page 250 and 251. You will see on 250, you will see the table A. That's when you're going to use the certain approach. And then you have got on page 251, you've got table B. That's your factors. So don't be alarmed. We have given it to you. And there it is. And just follow the formulas in that. All right. And practice them. Usually we don't ask this kind of calculations in exam papers. Usually. Can't guarantee that, but I have to admit these kind of calculations I've never seen in exam papers. Can imagine that can be difficult. I remember in my university years, many years ago, in those exam papers, we had the calculation like that. All right, then the schedule of factors, table A applies where the right is for an undefined period of life. Table B parties where the right is for a specified period. And that's where I'm going to stop that. You can read through the rest of that there. Going on then, on page 172, they show you the formula derived from section 1B and its provisions, and they show you there also on in the graphic there. A is the first usufruct here. There you have the substitution usufruct here, if that becomes relevant, if that happens indeed. And then of course the bare dominion heir, he actually inherits the property, it's his, but he can do nothing with the property before the first usufructuary heir has not died. And if there is a substitute usufructuary heir, he's got to wait it out and he can die before them. So all of these things have to be taken in consideration. You can see there in the bottom of page 172, A bequeaths his property to be subject to the usufruct of first C and then D. C, the first usufruct, it dies and the usufruct now continues to D. In this case, one has to determine the value of the usufruct passing to D and which is dutiable and sees his estate for estate duty purposes. Remember, we spoke about this for me yesterday, for you in a previous clip, and if there's one clip, then for you it is one moment we spoke about it. That's a calculation on its own. We're moving on to page 173, the main part of section 5.1b is applied in determining the value, and the most important parts are again reproduced below. Value of property in estate, the value of any property included in the estate of any person shall be B in the case of such a fiduciary, usufructuary, or other like interest as is referred to in paragraph A of section 3.2, an amount determined by capitalizing at 12% the annual value of the right of enjoyment of the property, and there they show you, to the extent to which the person who upon the cessation of the said interest of the deceased becomes entitled to any right of enjoyment of such property. Remember, it's into the future. Remember that over the expectation of life of such person, and then you are going to have to decide whether that's table A or table B. And there's the formula again. There they run you through the various formulas. You can practice that in your own time. And if you have a problem with them or you have a hiccup with them, then just post the question and we will get back to you and maybe give you a calculation or two if you are problematic with this. then we will assist you. They also give you the second provisio's calculations there in 5.1b. It reads as follows. I'm not going to read everything to you like a parrot. It has no purpose. So just go through it. And if you have a problem with that, then get back to us on that. All right. On page 176, again, they give you their graphic illustration. This can be illustrated as follows in terms of initial fair market value. A owns property. Property is left to B, which is the bare dominium holder, subject to the life usufruct in favor of C. So it's not a limited usufruct, 5-10 years, it's life. And then you've got to work it out. Value of property at A's death is 100,000 rand. The value of usufruct is calculated using tables assumed is 90,000. Therefore, the value of the bare dominium is 10,000 rand. And there they show you how they have arrived there. Then after, in order to calculate the second part, they assist you with those calculations again. I have other calculations. If you work through all of this, the value of the usufruct and all of this, and when it's dutiable and what liquidation distribution account you have to put it in, those calculations, I have some of those calculations. And if you have a question about them, then just ask us and we'll make some of those. Maybe those calculations would, to a certain extent, be a little bit more understandable than these ones. I've got other examples in other guides I've set up, and we will assist you. Don't think because I'm perusing over this that this is the end of it. It's self-study. Get down, understand it. If you don't understand it, get back to us, post the questions, and then I'm sitting in my chambers where I've got ample of time and I can assist you. All right. And I think you're also going to be awarded only one time feedback because you're also very busy. So be very careful of what you ask and ask the right questions. I don't know how many times you're going to be allowed to ask questions. I think it's a once-off. I'm not too sure. Page 177, they skip on giving you a lot of illustrative examples there. Please work through them. And on page 178, they give you a solution again, their graphic. And then they say, bear in mind at this stage that two calculations have to be made as the proviso limits the value of the lesser of the value of the seizing interest at the date of the usufructuary death and the fair market value of the property at the date of the usufructuary death less the value of the bare dominium when the usufruct was first created. You have to work through all of this and the calculations just keeps on coming. All right. So be careful with this. It's very difficult. I know it's very frustrating. But for me to sit here and try and work this out for you, we'll rather give you the opportunity to attempt it first practically, and then we'll address it later and deal with that. All right, I'm going to go on because I'm going to go on to page 180, and that is the fiduciary interest in the property. So very quickly, page to page 180, and then we'll start there again. Oh. That's Coke on the third day. Very happy to have Coke. Fiduciary interest in the property. Remember, these are all calculations. Massive calculations. And online, there's no way we're going to be able to explain this. We're assisting you here, and I will assist you further if you ask questions in another way. Differs from a usufructuary interest as immovable property is registered in a fiduciary's name. Accordingly, these assets appear in the fiduciary asset account, the regulation so-and-so, and in the estate duty schedule, whereas a usufructuary interest only appear in the estate duty schedule, and we just saw that in the liquidation and distribution account. Let's just take our time a little bit with this introduction. An example of a fideicommissum. I, Alan, bequeath my farm, plot 20 fee, Irene, to my eldest son, Bert, on condition that upon his death, the farm is to pass to my younger son, Chris. Alan owns the property and creates the fideicommissum. The property will appear in Alan's liquidation account. Bert, fiduciary heir. The property appear in Bert's fiduciary assets account and in his estate duty. Chris, fideicommissary heir. The property appears in Chris's liquidation account. Please mark this because I know for 23 pages, I've been rambling on around these calculations, not really talking about them, leaving it up to you to try first. And if you can do it, we'll assist you further. But this has been coming up the whole time. Where do I place it? And please mark this as very important. We've been talking now, most probably in your time, for 2 hours about it. I've been talking about it in real time from yesterday to today. So this part for me is very important because if you put it in the right place and you do your calculations, it's all going to work out. And this sets it out very well. And it's very easy to understand with that example above there. Bear the fiduciary heir has a limited right of use and enjoyment to the property. The property is registered in Bert's name. On Bert's death, the farm must pass to Chris, the fiduciary heir. Bert, while in possession of the property, may not alienate or sell the property since it must pass to Chris upon Bert's death. Bert has no testamentary rights over the property, underlined there. That's very important. And on Bert's death, the property passes to Chris in terms of their father, Alan's will. So there at the deeds office, this will be registered so that he cannot alienate this land. And this part of it, when they transfer the property, will be there. There's no other way of doing this. Otherwise, it will amount to fraud and theft and all of those things. When Alan dies, the property is owned by him and is reflected in his liquidation account. Alan creates the fideicommissum, which is to apply after his date of death. The property is then transferred to Bert. When Bert dies, he holds the property subject to the fideicommissum. Bert has no testamentary rights over the property. Property according cannot reflect in Bert's liquidation account. But as the property is registered in Bert's name, it must be transferred by Bert's executor to the fideicommissary heir, Chris, created in Alan's will. Remember, I said as executor, you got a lot of authority, but in some cases it's limited. This is one of those examples. You don't have a choice. You have to do it like this. And then it goes on there. A fiduciary asset account is created for this purpose. A usufructuary right appears only in estate duty schedule. The Estate Duty Act defines a fiduciary and usufructuary right as a property in terms of section so-and-so, and its value must be determined at the date of his death. Underline that, please. This is the problems that arise at his date of death and is brought to account in the estate duty schedule. Market value multiplied by 12%, multiplied by your factor, determined by the age next to birthday of Chris. That's table A, that's table B, and suddenly you've got to pick between the two, and suddenly you know where you are. Now, the last 5-7 pages, I've gone over so fast. This is actually what it amounts to at the end of the day. And although the calculations are very complicated, when you read page 181, you can actually understand it. Right, page 182. The property subject to the fideicommissum in Bert's estate is reflected in a fiduciary assets account for which provision is made in the regulation so-and-so. However, the estate duty purposes the full value of the property as held by Bert is not dutiable. Please underline that. Please underline that it's not dutiable. These things are important because then you mustn't do it. Only the value of the interest now passing to Chris is dutiable in terms of the Estate Duty Act. When Chris, the fiduciary heir, dies, the full value of the property will be reflected in Chris' liquidation account since full ownership now rests in him. Why? Because he's the last in the line of three parties through which this has moved. Well, you know, we must just understand one thing. People can die, have car accidents. And then, of course, that's going to hamper all of this. It's going to work out then depending on those set of circumstances. But that's, let's say everything go according to plan for Alan, who's the father. He started this whole process with his first will. Then this is how it's going to end. And now, just by reading this one page, now go back. Go back now. And now slowly read through the calculations. All right. And then if you have a further question, I have calculations that that I can send you. Value of fiduciary interest for estate duty purposes. It has already been stated above that a full value of the property, and these things are very complicated, I understand that, which was subject to the fideicommissum is not an amount which is dutiable. Only the value of the interest, which is deceased enjoyed during his lifetime, and which in parts of his goodness area is dutiable. So that's basically what I'm saying, what I said above. So make a note of them. How then does one calculate the value of this fiduciary interest held by the deceased during his lifetime? Section 5.1b, go and study the sections. If we refer you to a section and the section has not been quoted here, get on the internet, get an act, and go look what it's saying. Is self-study, distance learning, I have to emphasize that. Do your bit, you're going to be fine. You're going to be absolutely fine. is used in calculating this value. See what has been said in regard to use of flux above, as well as the discussion of the terminology used there. The formula to calculate the value of fiduciary right is the same as that used in the case of use of flux. Its application will be illustrated in the following examples, and then they show you there. They use Peter Punk. You can go through that in your own time. The value of a fiduciary interest in property passing to a sole fiduciary heir on the death of the fiduciary, and there it starts with Peter Punk dying on 1 November 2006. And when you page over, they actually show you very well how to do it. They've got some lines there. They tell you what is going where. Peter Punk, liquidation account, duty, sub account. Remember, sub account. Remember what we said in the first clip or second clip for you ongoing maybe, that you can have a liquidation account too. There's some of these divisions we spoke about. You can have a second one that you have to build in. And when you start working with this kind of thing, which is complicated, that's when it happens. Give it a good heading. Give it a good heading. Liquidation account number two, and then deal with these things. And there it is. Again, that Papa Foxtrot Mike Victor, multiply with 12%, multiply by F of person to whom right passes, and there you go. Now, this calculation, according to me, they set out very well. Follow this calculation, and you will be 100% fine. Thus, the value of the fiduciary interest at the bottom of page 183, passing to Barry Biker, in which is dutiable in Paul Punk's estate for estate duty purposes, is the amount of 145,000, and there you see it above. That, ladies and gentlemen, I think is a good example. It's a little better than that other pages we went through. I like what they've done here, and this will definitely work for you. Page 184, there they just speak about it again. All right. Quite a difficult couple of pages, wouldn't you say? Right, now we're going to annuities. Annuities, and my IT guy says, he's put a mic a little bit further away. He says that my voice, if the mic is too close, creates a problem. So hopefully this is much better. Annuities, introduction, section so-and-so includes its definition of property, the term annuity. Annuity, however, is not defined by the Estate Duty Act. In Morowitz states the following, and it gives you a definition there. Annuity is not defined, but its characterisms are as follows. That it is a fixed annual payment, if it is divided into installments, life insurance, whatever the situation might be. That it is repetitive, payable from year to year for, at any rate, a period of more than a year. That it is chargeable against property or is an obligation on some person, and not merely a payment at will. So there you have it. So there's no definition for it, but he is giving us the characteristics. The authority he quotes in support thereof is the following. We have a court case there from 1965, which still carries authority. And an annuity may arise in a variety of ways. It may be brought from an insurance company or granted by way of a legacy under the will or of a bequest and a trust deed. Bequest in a trust deed. So what could have happened here? It's a straight trust deed, or we have a will that said set up a trust. It was transferred in there, and we have somebody that ran out of age in 18, 21, 25, and there's a couple of ways it can land it in the trust deed. It may also be payable under the rules of a pension, retirement, and annuity fund. Voluntarily payments, however, if made regularly, do not constitute annuities. For example, a pension paid to a widow of a deceased employee that may be terminated by an employer at any time, or regular payments by a son to his father, which the son is free to discontinue at any time, does not constitute an annuity. Just to sort that out there. Broadly speaking, an annuity can be linked to a usufructuary, right, in that an annuitant, look at that, like a usufructuary is entitled to receive an annual amount without being entitled to the capital which produces that amount, but with the difference that with a usufruct, the amount of the capital fund or value, let me just switch out here, here's the paper I'm looking for, the amount of the capital fund or value of the property from which the usufruct is drawn is certain and specific, while the exact amount of income it will produce is uncertain from year to year, whereas with an annuity, the annual amount to be received is defined and certain, while the amount of capital required to produce the annuity is uncertain and subject to change depending on the prevailing rates of yield obtainable from time to time. That was a lot. The bottom line is, you either get a lump sum or you get paid out a restricted amount from year to year or some other period to other period. That's actually the differentiation that they're making. And that's almost like bearing a fruit, which means what? What does it mean? It means you're not entitled to a capital amount laying there, you're entitled to that yearly or other periodic dedicatedly amounts to pay out. Fumble over the English there, didn't I? All right, so that's what that is about. Do you understand that? Do you understand the difference there? You get a lump sum, or you don't get a laying lump sum there, but you get this other, you're entitled to these other amounts. And then that's the usufructuary, because that other sum can actually be bequeathed to, yeah, that's right, somebody else. All right, section 328B distinguishes between two types of annuities, and an annuity charged upon property and an annuity not charged upon property. So if we look at it, property means any right in order property, but we did that, so I'm not going to do that again. All right, so we're going on to 187 from 186. Let's just see where we are now with these papers flying around here. And then, of course, we did an annuity charged upon a property. All right, so I actually want to look at page 185. Let's go to page 185. And let me just get a couple of pages here from my right-hand side and just put him in here. Because when I work like that, it gets all muggled up. Right, page 185. Let's quickly then look at that annuity charged upon property. They ask you what is meant with that. Charged upon property is that there is some particular property or fund out which is annuity is payable. For example, an annuity is payable by the trustee from the proceeds of rental collected from a building, and which he is by will or deemed directed to administer. If a beneficiary is charged personally with the payment of an annuity, he's appointed the sole heir on the condition that he pays an annuity of 10,000 rand per annum to his mother during her lifetime. The right which he has to an annuity is not charged on the property. So that's the difference. That's basically actually what I said. And then if you go a little bit down on page 186, the two requirements then, for the existence of an annuity charged upon property, which will be property in the estate of a deceased, is the annuity must have been charged upon property, and the annuity must have been held by the deceased immediately prior to his death. All right, going on. And an annuity, the obligation of which to pay ceases before the deceased death, is therefore not property for the purpose of section 3.2. And they give you an example there, and the data they are giving you is Peter Powell. They actually say under the example, valuation of an annuity charged upon property for estate duty purpose, where the annuity does not continue to some other person, but reverts to the owner of the property on which it was charged. And then you can work through the data and you can arrive there at Powell. Quinton Powell's the solution there. So please work through that and in your own time. All right. On page 187, they give you everything. There you have it, the formula. Value of an annuity multiplied by F of owner of property on which, and that's the factor, né? F is the factor of owner which an annuity was charged. What is the necessary information quickly? Value of an annuity. The value of an annuity is the amount that's payable per annum. In this case, 12,000 rand. Supposing the payments are to be made monthly, the monthly payment must be multiplied by 12 in order to arrive at annual figure. And then they give you all that information. So please have a look at it and change the figures and see if you can manage through that. And then on page 188, let's quickly have a look at any other annuity. In the case of an annuity charged on property, it's further a requirement that an annuity be held by the deceased immediately prior to his death. If the annuity terminates prior to death, it's not proper to be valid for estate duty. In the case of any other annuity, it must not only have been enjoyed by the deceased immediately prior to his death, please, ladies and gentlemen, undersign that prior to his death, but it must also accrue to some other person on his death, i.e. a right to an annuity which is not a charge on property. Underline, it's not a charge on property. You'll see we've spoken about that, why it's a charge on property and why it's important to understand what that entails. And which ceases on the death of the holder is not property under the Estate Duty Act. If you don't understand this, you won't be understand to calculate these things. And if you do calculate them, then the answer you get is going to be wrong. All right. I'm going to stop that one there. And we're going to move on to property deemed to be property. You will remember, for me, it was yesterday. For you, that might be otherwise. We said that we're going to explain to you what is property deemed to be property. And by now, you must have thought we're not going to do it. Having some coke there, thank you very much. All right. What is it then? Let's have a look. Introduction. The estate of a person shall consist of all property of that person as a date of death, and all property which in accordance with the Estate Duty Act is deemed to be property of that person at date of death. Property is defined in section 3.2, which comprises all the property of the deceased at the date of death, where the same may be, wherever same may be situated. There is no territorial geographical limitation. Certain property, however, is deemed to be property of the deceased as at a date of death, simply because it is not property of the deceased at a date of death, such as an insurance policy or a accrual claim. There you have it. And I'm starting to think of an example, maybe a purchases contract for movables that was signed but not finalized, maybe something like that. I'm just trying to widen my scope here of deemed property. So keep that in mind, what I've said now. Some deal that's supposed to go through, and after death, the executor is going to have to push it through because he steps into the shoes of the deceased. That's what I'm thinking now. The assets only acquire value as a result of death and are accordingly payable after the date of death. In order to ensure that they are brought to account for estate duty, the Estate Duty Act deems them to be property of the deceased at the date of death. Yeah, there's no escaping, Sars. Tell you. You can try, you won't succeed. All right, on page 189, there are four categories of property deemed to be property of the deceased at date of death, namely a life assurance policy on the life of the deceased, a donations, mortis causas, accrual property of which the deceased was immediately prior to his death competent to dispose of for his own benefit or for the benefit of his estate. So he's going to sell something. He's going to sell something. All right, that's what I was trying to say previously. There's an outstanding agreement of sorts out there, and that's then point number four there. That was going through my mind, but there you have it, section 33D, and we're on course. At least we know what we're talking about, right? We're moving on to insurance policy on the life of the deceased. Now, we've already said a lot of this. Let me just get some more papers in here. Otherwise, I'm going to bugger you around. There we are. We've spoken a lot about life insurance policies and on the life of various people, and the deceased most probably most important ones. So let's have a look at what we are doing here. Introduction, a life assurance on page 189. A life insurance policy payable as a consequence of the death of the life assured is deemed to be property. There you have it. Start making a list and it's easy. Of that life assured and brought to account in calculating the estate duty of that life assured. It makes no difference who owns the policy or pays the premiums and whether or not there is a named beneficiary. The only link to the deceased is that the proceeds are payable as a result of his death and are therefore deemed to be property as the date of death and brought to account only in the calculation of the estate duty where the beneficiary is not a estate duty. We still are there. Remember what we said in previous links? Then we still have to bring it, because the big thing is actually policies is going to pay to somebody else. But if the beneficiary is the estate, the estate itself, then obviously there's a difference. But they will all be accounted for in some way or another. If there is no named beneficiary or the named beneficiary has predeceased, in that court case, Mkabela versus PPS Insurance Company and others, or the client or is Dignas unworthy. I have a case now on worthy Dignas, because he committed fraud, so he cannot inherit. The proceeds of the policy are payable to the estate and reflected at the gross mature value in the liquidation account. Not if there's a beneficiary outside that's alive, Joe Smo. Then we're only going to bring that lump sum paying out in consideration at an estate duty calculation. Remember what we said previously. Any outstanding levies, loans, advance payments are reflected in the liability section, normal route of the liquidation account. That's if there's nobody. So it's going to go into the deceased estate because somebody's dead or whatever the situation might be. If there is a named beneficiary, the net proceeds are deemed to be property of the deceased and reflected only in estate duty schedule. Man, we're getting clever. You're getting clever. Now this is starting to work out, right? Because we know now the difference. And if you know the difference, you know it goes there or it goes there, your calculations is going to work out. The advantages of nominating beneficiary in a life insurance policy are the following. I never put up a will. If I say, do you have a policy that you can change the beneficiary for this last will and testament? Otherwise, go get a 100 rand, 150 rand one. And let's just see if we can cover the expenses because you make the deceased estate a beneficiary. The beneficiary is paid immediately. This is now a little bit different. If the person dies, everything has to go through the deceased estate. So if there is a policy And the deceased estate is the beneficiary, then obviously it goes into the deceased estate. It's got to go through the whole winding up process. Not if the deceased died, he has life insurance, and the beneficiary is maybe his son. That's also an heir. He's an heir in the deceased estate. But he's been nominated by name in this policy. Then he gets paid out immediately. All right? So please remember that. Please remember that. The only way that money is coming into the deceased estate is if the deceased estate is the beneficiary, or as this court case has set out. The premiums paid by the beneficiary is plus interest at 6% are deducted in the calculation of the estate duty in the deceased estate. The proceeds do not appear in the liquidation section of the liquidation distribution according to the executor's fees are not payable. That's an important one for you. In the event of insolvency, the proceeds of a life insurance policy payable to a named beneficiary do not fall into the solvent estate and are paid. Okay, please mark that important. Remember, the owner of this policy, regardless of who's the beneficiary, is the deceased. Now, a lot of people would think, well, if the deceased estate is insolvent, he's the owner of the policy. Even Joe Smoes, the beneficiary, still has to go into the deep because it's an insolvent situation. No, it doesn't work like that. There you have it. That has no impact on the insolvency of the deceased estate. If Joe Smoe is the beneficiary under the deceased policy, Joe Smoe will get his money. All right, so please mark that as important. People ask you that kind of thing all the time. And then there's a court case too. Let's talk a little bit about maturity value and surrender value and see what we could do with that. Maturity value, it makes no difference who owns the life policy or who pays the premiums. The only link to the deceased is that the life policy maturity value is payable as a result of his death. In this event, the maturity value is deemed to be the property of the deceased and must be brought to account in the liquidation distribution account. If there is no named beneficiary, the maturity value appears in the deceased liquidation account. If there is a named beneficiary, then of course we go to the estate duty schedule. I'm not going to repeat myself. Surrender value. In the event of the deceased being the owner of a life policy over the life of another, on the deceased death, the deceased ownership of the life policy will constitute property in his estate, the value being the surrender value of the policy, if any, on the date of his death. The surrender value is property of the deceased or going to his liquidation account and not deemed to be property of the deceased because of his entitlement as a beneficiary. In the event of the surrender value applying, there is no adjustment of premiums in estate duty schedule because it's property and not deemed to be property. I'm going to stop it there. I was in a legal association for 4 to 5 years. A bunch of legal people that came together, attorneys and advocates, not official. You still had to get legally instructions, everything, but we were in an agreement that we're going to work with each other. And for 5 years, we just did criminal litigation, civil litigation, day and night, day and night. I even got myself accommodation in the city because you can't travel out and in again. So 4 or 5 years, just the whole time. Massive litigation. We went in for litigation, you cannot believe. And when we terminated this 4 or 5 years relationship, if I may call it that, we had about an 85% success rate on all cases, criminal and civil litigation. We signed policies on each other's name because we said we were only going to concentrate on each other. The work stayed within this circle, and it was very successful. It was very successful. And no, it was not a partnership. Obviously, an advocate and an attorney cannot be partners. So we just decided we'll just take instructions there, we'll just issue instructions there, and we were very busy. Then we took out these kind of policies. I think it was up to 5 million rand on each one of our lives. If the one would die, then it would go into the association, and the beneficiaries were detailed on how that would operate. Because when we decided to work in a group with each other, then it became important to also secure each other, because if one person falls away with all that knowledge built up in that group, then there can be, depending on your seniority, there can be a lack there that can crumble that institution. So we did something like this. Interesting. All right. Section 3, free states which policies are included and excluded as property deemed to be property. And I'm not going to go through with that. Go and read that. That's the act. You can study that. On page 191, they still go on there. From the above, they say at the bottom of page 191, we are talking about section 33A of the Act. And we're talking about property which is deemed to be property of the deceased includes. And then they go through that and they talk there. Well, maybe I must just look at something. They talk about the answerable buy and sell agreements, and they talk about key man. So please go and read up all on that. Then at the bottom of page 191, from the above, it's evident that the conditions which make the proceeds or any portion of the proceeds of a policy deemed property are the following, and that's what's important to me. It must be a domestic policy as defined in the Insurance Act. It must be on the life of the deceased, logically. There must be an amount due and recoverable under the policy, logically. There must be an excess of the amount recoverable, over the aggregate amount of premiums or consideration paid by the person entitled to the proceeds plus interest 6% per annum on such premiums or consideration from the date of payment to date of death. And that then is important that I want you to know. They also say there, interesting enough, the only connection with the deceased that is required is that the policy must be on his life. And except in the case of a specific exclusion mentioned, it is immaterial that the deceased did not affect the policy or that he had no financial interest therein. Years ago, when I had a company, a business in KwaZulu-Natal, on my model management, I actually took out, the company took out policies on their names. One policy for them, and then one policy in their key positions. If they die, then money will pay to the company. So they had two policies, one to their benefit, and one that would benefit the company, stuff like that. If we look at page 192, there in the middle, each of the four requirements above requires further inspection, domestic policy. So go and read up on that. On the life of the deceased, on the life of the deceased means it's submitted that death is the contingent upon which the amount becomes due. These are all logical things. Amount due and recoverable, that speaks for itself. The extent to which the proceeds are deemed to be property. Let's just quickly have a look at that. The total proceeds on the top of page 193, the total proceeds of the life assurance are deemed to be property of the deceased at the date of death. If, however, the beneficiary of the life assurance being a person other than deceased paid any premiums, we may deduct the total amount of all the premiums plus 6% per annum up to the value of the proceeds received in order to determine the amount of the deemed property in the life assured estate. It's kind of like a set-off, right? The reason that the deduction does not apply to the deceased himself is that he would amount to a double deduction. Of course, we cannot do that. That would be unfair. The deceased estate has paid the premiums during his lifetime. His estate is already reduced by these premiums, and to permit a further deduction of the premiums would amount to a double deduction. We don't want to do it. And then they give you an example. In order to illustrate what has been stated above, the following examples are provided. The following are the policies in the life of the deceased A, and there you can see the proceeds of the policy. The beneficiary of the policy is A, and there you can see the premiums paid plus 6% interest. So the proceeds is 15,000, 3,400, and it goes on like that. Then they say calculate the amounts to be included in A's estate in terms of section 33A, and they give you the solution there. And there we are. And of course, if you work through the solution there, you will see beneficiary A, whether A pay premiums or not, no deduction. Beneficiary B, 20,000 rand less premiums or 4,100. And beneficiary C, paid no premiums. And then owner F, of course, nee, exempt partnership policy. And then, of course, partnership is kind of the things I was referring to in my businesses years ago. Right, guys, there you have that one. That calculation is not that difficult. And I think all of that is quite understandable. Right. What about page 194, funds benefits? Funds benefits. Section 33A of the State Act has been deleted by the Revenue Laws Amendment Act. This amendment came into operation in 2009 and applies in respect of estate for a person who dies on or after that date. What date? 1 January 2009. And this is quite recently, actually. So 2009 is not that long ago when it comes to people dying. Fund benefits, provident, pension, retirement, annuity fund, and the commuted amount of any fund benefits are no longer deemed property. However, the commuted amount is deemed to be property in the estate of a person who died before 1 January 2009, and that must then only be dealt with where? Estate duty schedule. Are you starting to understand? And are you starting to get it? Are you listening? Are you hearing the language? There is interaction between the estate duty schedule and the liquidation account. So some things will go into the liquidation account. And if something differs, like in this case, before or after a date, it will go and be calculated in some other manner in the estate duty schedule. So the liquidation account and the estate duty schedule must also be considered. And if you are not certain, read up, ask around, research, and find out where they must go. We don't want the gross value. I'm telling you, we're in an exam or you're doing this work on your table. Get the gross value always correct. Regardless, I don't know how many of these calculations is actually done wrongly. That's my honest opinion. And the master never picks up on it. All right, donation mortis causa. A donation mortis causa is explained as a donation made in contemplation of death or a donation made on your deathbed. Let's have a look at it. Section so-and-so provides that any property donated by a deceased in terms of a donation which was exempt from donations tax under section so-and-so of the Income Tax Act, if that property is not otherwise included as property of the deceased for the purpose of the Estate Duty Act, will be property which is deemed to be property of the deceased. This section came into operation in 2005 and is applicable in respect of an estate of any person who dies on or after that date. You must actually make yourself a column or a summarized column of all of these things. This is now 8 November 2005. Wherever we work through this guide, and they say, well, before this date, it works like this. After this date, it works like this. You must actually type all these dates in the middle column. And then on this side, you have, well, if you died before this, then this happens. Died after this, this has happened. You must actually work through this guide and build something like that. Because some of these deceased states are around for 15, 20 years. There's one on my table that the seven children just can't agree on anything and it's never been winded up. And it's years. It's years. And every time I get him close to doing it, it's not happening. So that's what that is all about. In terms of section so-and-so, donations shall not be payable in respect. Donations tax shall not be payable in respect of the value of any property which is disposed under a donation as a donation mortis causa, in terms of which the donee will not obtain any benefit thereunder until the death of the donor. If a terminally ill person wants to donate money to a children, will this constitute a donation mortis causa? UTAS in the electronic service explains donation mortis causa as follows, and then we're going to move on. A donation mortis causa must be executed with the formalities for a will, which are a written form and signed by the, in this case, donor and two witnesses. The donation must be accepted by the donee prior to the death of the donor, but is nevertheless revocable by the donor at any time before his death, can still change the name in 5 seconds before the last breath is out, with respect, and falls away in the event of the prior death of the donee. That you can mark important, because I can see that if somebody's on the deathbed, you're going to have to need somebody there a printed agreement to this extent, part of a will, witnesses, everything. It's a little bit tense, wouldn't you say? It's a little bit tense. All right, guys, I'm going to move on. You can go on there, work through it. On page 195, the second one is where the donor will not obtain any benefit thereunder until the death of the donor. And the kind of case to which it would apply seems to be in those which the donor contracts to donate irrevocable property to a beneficiary or to a trustee for the benefit of a beneficiary, in terms of which its whole operation is suspended until his death or thereafter. I'm going to stop it there. That's in the middle of page 195. So those are the two ways that it can be done. Then we're going to quickly talk about claims in terms of Section 3.1 of the Matrimonial Property Act. The Matrimonial Property Act. So let's have a look at that, see what's happening there. The Matrimonial Property Act, the accrual system is aimed at a fair redistribution of the value of the assets accrued by the spouses during the marriage. That's the bottom of page 195. At the dissolution of a marriage, either by death or divorce. Since death dissolves a marriage, it is necessary to briefly deal with the manner in which this distribution takes place. The spouse with the smaller accrual, and if you have a problem with these calculations, if you really have a problem with these calculations, post a question. And what I will do back, a lot of we were told that we'll come back and we'll answer questions. But when it comes to mathematical calculations, I will also ask them to post on the e-leader platform if they can, rather written information, so that in specific calculations. Other things we can come online and we can answer them, it's no problem. But when it comes to calculations, we'll do it a little bit different to make it a little bit more easier for you. The spouse of the smaller accrual during the subsequent marriage is entitled to a claim against the other spouse for an amount equal to half of the difference between the accruals of the respective estates of the spouses. I want you to underline that, the smaller amount. Because that's the one that will benefit, right? The method of calculating the accrual in each spouse estate is generally intended into a separate schedule to the account, and that is something we also said yesterday. When is the claim in terms of this deemed to be property? And section 33CA tells us when. One is dealing with the situation where the deceased estate is a claim for half of the value of the accrual against the estate of surviving spouse assets, or the surviving spouse is a claim against the deceased spouse half of the amount, depending on who's the smallest. Right there with a pen. Depending on who's the smallest. The claim must be determined, calculated, and validated by the executor, who must reflect such claim in a liquidation account as an asset or as a liability, depending on is it entitled or does the deceased estate has to pay it out, to be paid by the estate to the surviving spouse. So I want you to have a look at it. You can work through it. It's fairly easy. And then, of course, they give you an example here. Work through the example and just understand it's the smallest amount that is relevant. And that will determine whether the deceased is entitled to it or whether the deceased has to pay it out. And that will bring about the fact whether it is going into the liquidation account and whether it's going into the liabilities account. That is actually self-explanatory and saying it like this, and you can rewind and listen to it over and over. It is not going to change. Page 197, paragraph 3.6.6, we're going into property over which the deceased was immediately prior to his death competent to dispose of. We kind of already touched it there, didn't we? We already touched on it in terms of, policies and annuities and things like that. So we just can talk a little bit more about it. Let me just get some of the scope down my throat. All right, good. We're about halfway in today's session. About 9 minutes to go, and then we're about halfway. Although I think we started early, so it might actually be over halfway. But I want to finish, even if we just page quickly and touch on things, I want to finish today with you so that you can get down to this. Property, yes, there it is. Section 33D provides the property which is deemed to be property of the deceased includes property being or not otherwise chargeable, and remember what we said previously, under the Estate Duty Act, or the full value of which is not otherwise required to be taken into account in the determination of the dutiable amount of the estate of which the deceased was immediately prior to his death competent to dispose for his own benefit or for the benefit of his estate. And you can go and look at Section 35 states, and you can look at everything they're saying there. And you also can go and look at them in B35B, where they talk about that. On the bottom of page 198, in both of the forms of power, the actual exercise of this power is not the issue. If the power could potentially be exercised, the deceased was competent to dispose. The power and competency of the deceased, as described in the deeming provisions, need never have been exercised. Competency to dispose of property is not sufficient to ensure that property falls within this very section, 3.3. The deceased must have been competent to dispose of the property for his own benefit or the benefit of the estate. That's the qualification. That's the emphasis. It is said that even if a deceased retained wide powers over property and exercised his powers thereby disposing of the property, it will not incur estate duty, underline this, as long as the dispositions are not for the benefit of the deceased or his estate. And I'm telling you, this one, a lot of people don't know. So please have a look at that, because you have to determine this. You have to look at the documentation. You have to look at the evidence in front of you. You've got to ask questions to arrive at this or not arrive at this. And on account of that makes the decision as to how you're going to deal with this. So that is very important there. The intention of the legislature is to capture property which is in effect that of the deceased, logically, but has been dealt with in such a way that it would not fall into the dutiable estate, but for the deeming provisions of 33D section there. All right. Good. I think we're happy there. Let's put that page away. Right. Allowable deductions. Section 4 deductions. There's many of them. Let's quickly peruse through them. We've already touched on so many of these things when we did the liquidation, the distribution account. We're just repeating ourselves. But I'm telling you, there is one thing I have to say now. A lot of these calculations are column-free calculations. A lot of these complicated calculations are column-free calculations. So you're going to do these calculations column-free, then you will determine if you're going to put them right through to column 1 or column two. And remember, I'm counting column one, two, three from the outside in. So if it's in front of me, then one, two, three. Three will be right beside the information column, in case you were wondering. All right. So column three is quite important, especially according to me, and my honest opinion and advice, when you work with these calculations of usufructs, fideicommissaries, commissaries, fideicommissums, commissions, habitatio, usus, there's so many of them that I can throw out at you. Page 199, allowable deductions. All right. In order to determine the net value of the deceased estate, the Estate Duty Act provides for the following deductions. These deductions are set out in section so-and-so 4A to Q of the Estate Duty Act. Now, please, that's where you have to bring that itemized parenthesis in brackets numbers in, and you've got to do it 100% correct. Because when you get to your addendum, at the end, when you calculate your estate duty, you saw in the example I showed you when we started, that's the end. Can't make a mistake there. And whatever you do there is going to lead to something on that deduction of the rebate of the 3.5 million, whether it's going to be dutiable or not at a rate of 20%. All right. So you got to be right. It just has to be right. All right. These deductions are set out in those sections. Only those encounters most frequently in practice will be dealt with below, because there's many. You can think for yourself. There's so many expenses that you can think of. That can come around. Maybe there's foreign things that happen, expenses from there. So there's a lot of things that if you make a list of them, it will just go on and on. Let's see what happens. The fair and reasonable cost of a funeral, tombstone, and deathbed expenses. Are we going to talk about it? No, I don't think so. We already did. Except to say it's not under the administration expenses. Yep, you got it. It's a creditor. Liabilities of the deceased. Well, let's just have a look at this. All liabilities of the deceased to persons ordinarily resident in the Republic are permitted. All right, they say now in the Republic, right? The debts due by the deceased are not subject to the fair and reasonable adjustment by the commissioner provided for in Section 4A. Just remember, when you have foreign assets, then there's bills you have to pay too. Whatever debts are due and owing by the deceased person or ordinarily resident in the Republic are permitted as an expense in determining the net value of the estate. Where the spouses were married in commutative property, the administration fees and creditors due by both parties at the date of death are included in the account. In the distribution estate day schedule, the funeral expenses is adjusted to be an expense only of the deceased and not in community expense. Take note of that. Death devolves a marriage in commutative property. Funeral expenses incurred after the date of death and calling expense only by the deceased, and it will only be under the creditors column. There you have an income tax case. You can go and study. What is administration expenses? Advertising, bank charges, page 200. Cost of valuing assets, cost of realizing assets, security, transfer costs, post of petties, bond cancellation costs, cost of preserving assets, master's fees, and executor's fees. Because there can be a misunderstanding here. If there's foreign assets and there is certain bills and administration costs and valuation costs that has to be paid there, don't get confused now. If you have to have a valuator in America, evaluate the property in America, and then, of course, that is an expense if the person owns something there. That's going to have to be dealt with. It's going to have to be dealt with. Don't think that you cannot dealt with it, because if he's paying all those bills out of South Africa to these places, think about it. Okay, they may be deducted under the section. The administration expenses differ from creditors' claims in that they are all incurred after date of death. So this is something you've got to underline, because we have emphasized funeral expenses creditor because after date of death. Just underline this, that all expenses after date of death, according to what I am saying here. Administration expenses incurred and given effect to the provisions of the Estate Duty Act. They're on page 200 still. Any expenses incurred by the executor in giving effect to the provisions of the estate duty may be deducted under this section. An example of this type of deduction would be the valuation cost incurred in appraising property subject to usufruct or fideicommission, or valuing a property in terms of the master's instructions. There you go. All right, foreign assets. Estate duty is leveled on the universal property of the deceased, which includes foreign property. Section 4E provides for a deduction of foreign property in certain circumstances. Note, if the deceased was not an ordinary resident in South Africa at the date of his death, then all foreign property owed by the deceased is excluded from the calculation of the estate duty. Remember what we said previously? Ordinary resident. ordinary resident. Estate duty is then payable only on the deceased property physically situated in South Africa. Ordinary. If the deceased was an ordinary resident in South Africa at the date of his death and owns foreign property, the foreign property may be deducted in terms of Section 4E. There you go. In the following circumstances, the property must physically be outside South Africa. The property situated outside South Africa must acquire by the deceased before he became an ordinary resident in South Africa for the first time, or after he became an ordinary resident in South Africa for the first time by a donation or an inheritance, and then, of course, out of the profits or proceeds of the foreign property coming into his bank accounts and coming in, or whatever the situation might be. There's your solution. All right. And I have to use this afternoon in a legal opinion, because there's somebody who doesn't know, and they've asked me. The value of a bequest to a public benefit organization. Here we go. That's important to look at. A bequest to a public benefit organization, previously referred to as a religious, educational, and charitable institution, is deductible for estate duty purposes. I'm going to stop it there. On page 202, usufruct created by a pre-deceased spouse. The value of a usufruct included in an estate which was created by a pre-deceased spouse, but only if no deduction was allowable in the estate of the pre-deceased spouse in terms of section 4Q. Let's say a little bit more about it. Where the deceased enjoyed the usufruct immediately prior to his death, such usufruct is property by definition, and it will be dutiable in terms of Section 3 of the Estate Duty Act. However, if the usufruct was created by a pre-deceased spouse and the property in question formed part of the pre-deceased spouse's estate at the time of his death, then the value of the usufruct in the second dying estate will be deductible in terms of Section 4M, and you can take it further from there. Just underline those things I've said now, because they're quite important. What about the accrual section? The value of an accrual claim by the surviving spouse in terms of the matrimonial property, Section 4, I capital A, just as a claim for accrual by the deceased against the survival will be reflected in as an asset, so will a claim for accrual by the survivor against the deceased be treated as a deduction in the for the estate duty purposes. Go and look at that. Still on page 202, objects of art lent to the government of South Africa. You get this quite a lot. I know you're close to us outside Bronkhorstspruit at I think it's Baia Dam. It's quite a well-known sculpture. And one can imagine that he might be lending something to the government for 99 years or whatever the situation might be, or to a museum or something like that. The value of any book, picture, statuary, sculpture, or other objects of art which are lent under the notarial deed to the government of the Republic for a period of no less than 50 years. All right, no less than 50 years, my apologies. And the deceased dies during such period. In practice, if one has an object of art of great value, it will have to be valued and estate duty paid on it, which may result in a sale of that article in order to pay the estate duty. Please be mindful of this provision. It certainly could make a real difference in advising. So a client in his estate planning exercise. Yeah, I must admit, this is a question that I don't think many people ask. Do you have something that's really out of the ordinary valuable? Does it fall under this notarial deed of the government? Or is it just yours and it's really expensive, because then you have to declare it and so on. So I get a lot of people that says to me, we have a Rembrandt or a Picasso, whatever the situation might be. I'm just throwing examples out there. But a lot of people say to me, we've got this thing and this is really significant. It's worth millions of rands. Please, then you have to follow this. Page 203. Whatever accrues to the surviving spouse as a result of the death of the deceased, any amounts which accrues to the surviving spouse, whether it be in the form of a legacy, an inheritance, or payment for life insurance policy, is deductible under the section. I'm not taking it further. Something has popped into my mind. When we did example this morning, do you remember that rebate was 3.5 million rand? So just remember what I said about the surviving spouse. Didn't I say 7 million? So just something there. Just go back and have a look at it, because I don't think I mentioned it today in the third clip. Right. There's a lot I say about this. The amendment came into operation after 20 June 2001. So there's something you have to look at it again. Take note that the division of spouse was changed, and just take that into consideration also. I'm not going to talk about that. They talk about civil unions there, union recognized as a marriage, and that is how that goes on there. Page 204. application of the FRIF decision. All right, calm down. Let's just take a breath here before we deal with this very important court case. All right. I'm going to go through this court case slow, and we're just going to touch on the most important aspects of it, and so that you are familiar with it. It is important to take note of the decision in the Thrifts estate case of 2001. In an article by Mr. Carl Cornelissen published in South African Institute of Chartered Accountants, they discussed it as follows. In terms of Section 4 of the Estate Act, the net value of any estate shall be determined by deducting from the total value of all property included in the estate as envisaged in Section 3, amongst others. The value of any property included in the estate that has not been allowed as a deduction under any provision or Section 4 which accrues or accrued. Any public benefit organization which is exempt from tax. Any institution, board or body which is exempt from tax. And it goes on a little bit more about sole and principal objects. The state or any municipality. The deduction allowable shall be reduced by so much of any amount as the surviving spouse is required in terms of the will of the deceased to dispose of to any other person or trust. And then in two, no deduction shall be allowed in respect of any property which accrue to a trust established by the deceased for the benefit of a surviving spouse, if the trustee of such trust has the discretion to allocate such property or any income therefrom to any person other than a surviving spouse. All right. Bequest to charitable institutions and the surviving spouse. So that is what I say there. So please, the fifth decision in the Supreme Court of Appeal in 2001 was rather important. So just read through it and have a look at it. Space number two. Space number two. Because number two is on a condition within the discretion of a trustee to give away to other than the surviving spouse. So obviously, you're going to have to look at the trust deed. Now, when I put up a will, I put the conditions in the will of the trust, if they want the trust. And then that's easy enough. But if they just say you must open a trust, you're going to have to read the trust and look at the discretion of the trustees. And yes, nobody does it. I know. So you got to do it to do these things right. Then I talk there about bequest to charitable institutions and the surviving spouse. As indicated above, out of that, the bequest made in terms of Section 4 is to certain institutions and deficiencies will qualify as a deduction for estate duty purposes. It is important to know, David, that deduction applies to both monetary accruals, which is money accruals, and those accruals that that may be put into money terms. For example, where the usufruct or an annuity of fiduciary interest which the deceased enjoyed at the time of his death accrues to qualifying institution, that accrual will rank as a deduction when determining the net value of the estate. So just work through this. Calculation of the estate duty at the bottom of 205, where the bequest of the residue is deductible. The quantum of such deduction is not required to be reduced by the amount of estate duty that will be payable in respect of any other bequest. And I can feel I'm losing you. I can actually feel it, even though you're not really sitting in front of me. I can feel I'm losing you. So what I want to say to you is just read through these pages. It's very theoretical, and have a working knowledge of it so that if this problem presents itself in front of you, you know what to do. This is theoretical. So although it's going to amalgamate into calculations and so on, the application is theoretical. On page 206 above, they come back to the Thrifts case. However, in the Thrift decision in which Mr. Thrift was the executor, the estate challenged this form of calculation. The estate adopted the approach that the value accruing to the surviving spouse that was deductible in terms of Section 4Q was not first affected by the liability to pay estate duty. In finding in favor of the estate, the court criticized what is called the commissioner's engagement in arithmetic or algebraic gymnastics, and that was sarcastic. The judge was sarcastic in making that ruling. All right. So let's have a look at it. I just want to look at this. That's there. Just give me a second, I've got to go through these pages here. All right, that's as to the method of calculation state, who delivered my job. Okay, let's look at what he said about the calculation. All right. On page 206, just below that, where he was sarcastic, the judge says the following. The determination of the dutiable amount in the act is to follow a process by one is able to establish the charge which is to be raised in the executor's liquidation as distribution account. I find nothing in the act to suggest that a very charge one is seeking to determine is to be used to determine itself. There is furthermore nothing in section 4Q to suggest that it's concerned with what the surviving spouse will ultimately receive from the executor. What it is concerned with is the determination of a charge which must be made against the estate and therefore include as a charge in the account. Which account will establish the sum, if it is a monetary amount, which the surviving spouse will receive. The focus is on what the surviving spouse is entitled to from the will, not his, her ultimate cash receipt. A little bit sarcastic there too again. That this is so in my view, is in my view supported by the wording of the section which concludes itself with the value of any property included in the estate and not with the surviving spouse. This inherent circularity of the procedure that the appeal judge follows judgment suggests would seem to me to be totally unnecessary if the relatively simple scheme of the act is followed. The scheme of the act is that estate duty is to be charged on a dutiable amount calculated in accordance with the provisions of the act. And that is what we've been teaching you the whole time. What constitutes an estate for a purpose is expressly set out in section 3. The net value of the estate is determined by making the specified deductions, which do not in terms include deductions of notional amounts. Section 4. Thereafter, an additional abatement of 1 million is made. Section 4.8. That has changed. That's different. The appellant's contention thus would seem to rest on the introduction into the process of computation of a deduction which is not provided for in the Act. All right, so there I'm going to stop with that. I'm not going to take that further. What I did do here is this really confirms the established principle of interpretation, and that is the word should be given the ordinary grammatical meaning. The court in the estate first came to the conclusion that a clear language of the act supported the view that when determining the estate duty liable, one should not take in account of the ultimate cash receipt to the surviving spouse. This can be illustrated by example provided by Mr. Firth, and we have it in here. What is this court case talking about? It's talking about that we must follow the law, and we must give the normal interpretation to the law and not read into the law what we're not supposed to read into it. That's basically what it is. All right, on page 207, they're giving you that calculation there, you have to deal with it, and then it also gives you the conclusion at the end. And that runs up to 2008. So you can go through it there. You can see how they worked it out. There's a dutiable amount of 1 million. Be careful of that. And then duty thereupon is your 20%. There they have the 3.5 abatement. There was possibly, when I read it, I saw there could be confusion. 3A does not relate to the million rand. It's important. And then just follow this example here and you'll be fine, because at the end of the day, follow the act. Follow the act and be careful. Based on Mr. Firth's example, it's clear that by planning one's estate in accordance with the will one above, the executor will end up paying 25% more estate duty to the commission than payable in will two. For the aforesaid example, it's clear that a cash saving in 25% can be achieved through careful estate planning. The results in an effective 20% saving in estate duty. However, it's important to note that had a tester in Mr. First example bequeathed 3.5 million to his children and the whole of the rest to the surviving spouse, no estate duty was payable. Thus, the point to be made is that with proper planning, one can save, and so it goes on. All right, good. Let's get some more papers out here. Stay with me. We're almost there. All right. Get some coke in here. Okay. Some coke from McDonald's. The IT guy is supporting our dry throats here. All right. Page 208. Calculation of section 4H and 4Q deduction where a public benefit interest again. And do surviving spouse are the beneficiaries or co-beneficiaries of the residual of an estate. What is the residual? It's the residue, right? It's what's over. So let's have a look at it. If estate duty is payable by the estate, it should be recorded in the liquidation account after the liabilities. The total amount of the gross value of the assets less the total liabilities less the amount in respect of estate duty payable is equal to the balance available for distribution. You would remember that we ran estate duty null, 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 and suddenly in that example at the end, we saw what it was. So you must just get those calculations always right. It will not always be null. If the estate duty account, you will deal with section 4A to 4Q deductions, and you actually write it in the estate duty calculations. In terms of section 4H, a bequest to a public benefit organization and section 4Q in amount which accrues to the surviving spouse, whether it be in the form of a legacy, an inheritance, or payment from a life insurance policy, is deductible under these sections. It is not a challenge where the value of a cash legacy awarded to a public benefit organization or spouse must be deducted. Challenge arises when they are the beneficiaries or co-beneficiaries of the residue. You might find yourself in a catch-22 situation. On the one hand, one could not determine how much of the surplus these registry heirs will receive. Thus, how much to deduct in terms of either section 4H or 4Q until the estate duty has been calculated. On the other hand, one could not calculate estate duty until one knew how much to deduct from the surplus awarded to these restitutionary heirs. If estate duty is payable, it should be deducted from the total cash on hand in the recapitalization statement. At last, we are stating that, the obvious. The recapitalization statement cannot be recorded before the estate duty addendum is finalized. So what is happening sometimes with the recapital statement is you'll see they interact, like the liquidation account and the estate duty schedule interact. You have a definite interact in terms of the recapital statement and the estate duty addendum. But people manage to actually finalize the recapital statements beforehand. The deductions, other terms, section 4Q and the estate duty addendum will be calculated as follows. First, deduct any legacies awarded to spouse. Then deduct any policies paid directly to the spouse. That will priority with a subtotal. Because the spouse is a registered heir, residuary heir, you must calculate the amount that a spouse will receive as part of the residue of the estate. Take the subtotal, subtract all benefits to heirs that should not be deducted in terms of section 4 from the subtotal. First, deduct the value of the legacies, assets plus cash awarded to legatees. Thereafter, deduct the value of any other benefit awarded to any other beneficiary not deductible in terms of section 4. Then, deduct the value of any property deemed to the property added in the estate duty addendum and that was paid to a beneficiary. Calculate the subtotal. Then you divide the subtotal by the number of residuary heirs. If spouse and so on is not the sole residuary heir, this will provide you with a value of the amount that can be deducted as allowable in section 4H to 4Q deduction. And there you have it. So you can actually work this out. You can actually put in figures and you can actually practice this. Primary rebate, bottom of 209. I'm not going to talk about that. We've spoken about it enough. The rebate is 3.5 million rand. And if you deduct that rebate and you come up still with a surplus, then obviously 20% estate duty dutiable on it. So you can go and look at that in your own time. Read through page 210. They talk there about a lot of things there. In the middle of page 210, the portable spousal deduction only applies where the survivor of a preceded spouse done or after 1 January 2010. Just take cognizance of that. The consequence of this means to permit a rollover, portable spousal deduction of the unclaimed duty for the first dying estate to the survivor who dies on or after 1 January. Take note of that. Since that day, the survivor qualifies for a rebate of 7 million less whatever portion of the relevant rebate applicable at a first dying death was used claimed by the spouse. And then you can go and look what they explained to you there further. It runs from 210 to 211. Dutiable amount, I'm not going to talk about it. By now, you ought to know it's 20%. You ought to know that at the end, you have to rebate your 3.5 million rand. If it's under 3.5, it's not applicable. If it's above 3.5, it is applicable. We've said that over and over. And then they actually give you a good, in the Frifs decision, they actually give you your personal liability, estate duty there in terms of Section 11. They've got you set out there explaining the sections there. Then on page 212, coming to the end of this guide, apportionment of the estate duty. I just want to go through this a little bit in more detail with you. It must be noted the deceased estate is not necessarily responsible for the payment of all the estate duty which may be levied as a result of his or her death. Section 11 of the Estate Duty Act provides that certain beneficiaries are liable for a pro rata share of the estate duty. Section 11 sets out exactly who is responsible for the payment of that duty. Section 30 is also important since it provides for the manner in which estate duty must be apportioned. These sections must be read together. In terms of Section 11, read to Section 13, duty is apportioned by determining the ratio between the net benefit receiver, by whoever is responsible for payment, in relation to the net value of the estate, as against the estate duty payable in that estate. The calculation will therefore be the following. There they give it to you, the net value of the benefit, policy, usufruct, whatever, divided by the net value of the estate, multiplied by the estate duty payable. Please take note of this, as this is important. And then the last thing we're going to do before we're going to work through the annexures, the rebate on successive deaths, designed to provide a measure of relief where estate duty is payable on successive deaths within 10-year period of the first dying, where such estate was assessed and payable by the first dying. A special rebate is given in respect of property included in the estate which formed part of the estate of a person who died less than 10 years after the deceased, designed to provide a measure of relief. Death in quick succession. If any part of the duty is charged in respect of the value of any property on which duty had previously been payable, on the death of another person at any time within the 10 years to the death of the deceased second dying, the amount of duty attributable to the value of the property is reduced according to the following scale. The amount of estate on the estate of the second dying will be reduced by 100% if the second dying dies within 2 years of the first dying person. How about that, eh? 80% if the person 2 to 4 years, 40 to 6 years, 40% 6 to 8 years, and 20% 8 to 10 years. There you have it, ladies and gentlemen. That was 6 hours, a little bit more than 6 hours of an online training at one hectic speed, and you are afforded questions. So now you'll have the opportunity to look at this and come back to us, and then we can then address it further. It is a complicated subject, so ask us the necessary questions. Now we're going to go through the annexures. We are starting on page 214. The annexures are starting on 2015, and it's important to do it for me because this is practical. Now you're going to hear what we said theoretically. Right, there's your death notice you have to fill in on page 215, and it runs through to 116. Remember, when you report your deceased estate, there is your death notice. There is your inventory, 2017, and that runs through. And it keeps on running actually up to page 221. Remember, the values you put in here can later change. But we quickly just want to find out what's going on. Are we liquid? Are we insolvent? And as a matter of fact, what is the value of the estate? So that is your third inventory. And you will see when you come through it. Let me page through it for you. It's very easy to follow. Never had a problem with it. On page 219, you put all your immovable properties in there. On page 2, you put your movable properties in there. And in page 221, you put your claims in favor of the estate in there. Now you can actually have a kind of idea. Are you picking it up? How your liquidation account, in terms of your movables, look in terms of the liquidation and distribution account. And at the bottom of page 221, you do your calculation. Then you had your nomination to act as executor or master's representative. Executor, normal big winding up. Master's representative, section 183, deceased estate. And there you utilize that document there, as well as the acceptance of trust as executor on page 223, which is the J190. Then you have your executorship, where the master will then approve you. That is on page 225. And what did we say? We said until this, you have this letter, be careful. But remember what we also said. You can have an interim curator be appointed if it just takes a long time. And we still spoke about that 1/8%, or if it's 1/8%. Do you remember? Your J115 undertaken, accept the master's directions. There you have that. There, your J115 that has to be looked at. You have your, on page 228, your letters of authority. And that letters of authority usually are done for your 18-3. You can see at the top, it says it there. You have your normal affidavits. There on 229, you have your declarations you have to do, your affidavits, and then, of course, your special power of attorney. Ladies and gentlemen, if the special of power of attorney is very important. It's very important that you read through it. You can make it better, but you cannot make it less. This is minimal requirements. Then, of course, on page 223, the particulars of next of kin. And then again, if you're going to do our undertaking of a bond of security, I spoke about that. That runs from 234 to 235. And that's with that specific institution, the LIIF or something like that. And I told you a story about that. If it is necessary, you have your surety ships by your natural persons, your J262 on page 236. You have everything here you need in terms of official documentations to show you how to do your work. There's another surety ship by insurance company, bank, financial institution, and so on. And then you have your notice to creditors and deceased estates. You can utilize that. That's great. You can either write a letter or you can do that. But why not use form J193? A lot of people just write a letter, but it's better to rather do it like that's very official. On page 241, the liquidation distribution accounts and deceased estates line for inspection. That's when you do the 21 days, and that is how you will facilitate that. And on page 242, you will see the master's fee there, assessment of the master's fee. And then 2243, this will be your query sheet with your four three divisions. They run there, and you can see there that this one has been queried. It's a memorandum, and this is what I will send back to you. You can still see the stamp there. When we place the 244, there's your application for any kind of endorsements, and that runs up to page 245. Page 246, you have your letters of appointments. You can have a look at that. And on page 247, we have your JM21 memorandum. Again, you can go through that, which also, amongst other things, deals with your certificate of adhesion and repudiation. Then on page 249, there is your Master Shah High Court Johannesburg. There's some correspondence there. This one, you can have a look at that, where they, amongst other things, this list is not being construed as a formal discharge. So it's not a formal discharge. So have a look at that. Table A and B on page 250 and 251. So that's your factors, your F. Your factors when you do those complicated calculations does make certain. We showed you there when table A is being used. We showed you when table B is used. Another important thing is don't be too fast to ask questions if you haven't read your whole guide. It's imperative that you read your whole guide. And what you can do now is actually first you read your whole guide and then you do your guide again. We look at this presentation and then you post questions. Then on page 252, the administration of the estate regulations, we've given it to you. That runs up to page 256. It actually still goes on, if I'm not mistaken. On page 256, you have your administration of estate, your extension of the period there. On 257, you have your regulations 911, 910, regulations prohibiting the liquidation or distribution of the estate of a deceased person by any person other than an attorney, notary, conveyancer, or law agent. You've got to look at that for us. That goes on, that runs up there. And then, of course, on 260, you have your list of documents for first consultation. Guys, here you are. We've given you everything. This is your list for your first consultation. What you need of the deceased, what you need of the surviving spouse, what you need of the pre-deceased spouse, the divorced spouse, the children. Look at this. take this template, this, and it's going to help you so much. And remember what I said about the first consultation. You don't get him together again, and later on you start having trouble to talk to people, they disappear. Then on page 263, we've built it in a step-by-step procedure after letters of executive grantors. Yes, step-by-step, what do you do up to signing of your liquidation distribution account? We give you some info though as how to deal with that. Then on page 265, we've included the bond of security with the LPIIF. Just spoke about it now. Here's everything about it. Previous guides did not have this in. So we bolded this in so that when you go for that first bond of security, and remember, you only have to do this, this reference letter from a guy like me on whose supervision you're going to work if it's your first time. There you have everything about them, what they require of you, and so on. Then on page 276, so these annexes are immensely important. If you read through your guide, go look at your annexes. We've put a lot of stuff in here that actually shows you how to go about it, breaking down into a more practical application than all the theory we have dealt with in that guide there. Chief Master's Directive there, page 275. Purpose of this director, purpose of the director is the director of all masters and the performance of functions. This director is issued in terms of so-and-so. Please go through all of this. They give you a lot of information there. And posties and petties. Background, that's from 1 October 2016 on page 277. So it's important for you to have there. Then we look at precedents. Example of a liquidation distribution account. We give you a scenario. This is the one we dealt with when I started out. And we're going to page through it again now. And there you are. You can look at this. When you look at it, it seems easy, but yes, to put something up like this. And this is a complicated one, a seriously complicated one. And up to page 293, we're still paging. And on page 294, then we are finished there. Now we have application in terms of section 38 and affidavit. Have a look at that affidavit from the surviving spouse. That is important there. Have a look at that annexure there. The deceased full name is so and so on. And then, of course, we remember what we said about these documents. The surviving spouse has to sign them. Page 296, there you have an example of a redistribution agreement again. Remember, we spoke about an example of a redistribution agreement. And I told Sergio, it's better whatever you do after you sign. And there we have an example for you. We have another example for you on page 297. So there's really no reason not to know what to do. We've got everything for you. As a matter of fact, if your principal is having a problem, you can just pull this book out and say, hey, guess what? I might be the junior or the candidate. Yeah, I know the answer because my book has it. Page 298, there you have the intercession, succession, interstate succession question and answers. So have a look at that. There they give you the calculations, everything. Remember, testate, testament. Intertestate, no testament, and we break down some of this in page 299 for you. And then that's it. We're in page 300, there's some relevant acts you can go and study, and so on. I just want to look at it quickly. Administration, interstate, wills act, estate, main recognition, reform, attorneys, electronic combinations, your notices. Yes, I'm happy with that. I'm happy with that. Go and read them. Your Interstate Succession Act, here we have attached it for you. So you can have it with you, page up and down with it. And your Trust Property Control Act, we have thrown in here. Please have a look at that. It's not very long. Do yourself a favor and read about it, because apart from deceased estates, one of my specialities is also putting up trusts, and it works like a bomb. All right, guys, that's it. That's it. That's where the truck stops. All right. Okay, guys, I know it has been fast. We are putting this very up quickly for you, because due to COVID, some of the UNISA University venues, if I'm not mistaken, does not give this institution is partnered there, and COVID has prevented guys like us on a notice board working you due to the COVID issue. So this is what we're doing now. We're leaving it up to you. Come back to us. You will see me. In another session, and then we'll deal with some of your problems, and they'll send it to me beforehand. And if you have calculation problems, That I will deal in another way. We'll solve those problems and post it in a report on the eLadder platform, because then you can look at it. We might still talk about it online, but when it comes to mathematics, we'll post pertaining to your questions. Thank you very much. I'm out of here, which means I'm going to go in here and I'm stopping to record now. Good luck. And let's say I hope all of you become excellent litigators, attorneys, advocates, legal consultants, legal advisors, prosecutors, judges, magistrates. The world's open to you under this degree and this kind of training. Good luck, and I'll talk to you later when I'm back to answer your questions.